Very well, then. Let's move on. Oleg Teterin. Is that correct, Oleg? Here is his biography, or, you know.
Thank you. So, hi, everyone, and happy to meet some colleagues who I know personally, like Jose, Aubrey, Lise, Didier, Lia, Martin, and I'm very open to meet others, too. So I'm in the longevity field is like only 4 years and a little bit new to most of you, and trying to figure out how my energy and vision can extend active lifespan. So during my journey, I learned things, well, you all probably know that people die of age. There is no one who died from the disease. People die of diseases, not from the age, sorry. Every day there are about 115,000 who die. And they're up to 25% of the deaths due to doctors' mistakes in the countries where they've been counted. The worldwide medicine is based on symptoms. Usual amount of tests doing by the biochemical tests is about up to 20 parameters only. You will get more tests only if something would be shown in these 20 markers. And we believe it's already late. So medicine all over the world resists hyper over-diagnostics, and we believe this is the key to our active longevity today. We learned that most of severe diseases survivors, actually not the survivors, their healthy aging was stolen from them from the end of their life. So no matter how promising it sounds, people who survived, if they would be tracked earlier, they would have lived probably plus some extra years. Then I learned that no matter how promising news headlines are, humanity is losing battle with death, because until now, almost zero trials on humans are being done. Maybe besides Yamanaka, but it goes with the eyes, and correct me if I'm wrong, which are clinical trials on anti-aging and longevity right now are being held on humans. So I found out that scientific and medical society is quite closed, and not so much transparency in it as should be. Maybe it's because that some of previous assumptions after some time passed were considered wrong and not everyone brave enough to admit it. And sometimes it's even misleading the society. Remember in July 22, there was this revealed Alzheimer's images fraud case. Then I saw that there's a surprising competition going on in the longevity field, and fundamental science is severely underfunded. You can see how much COVID was funded last year or 2 years in a row. And at the same time, I believe longevity and anti-aging movement was on fundamental level funded with the about maybe Hollywood blockbusters movies per year, which is the criteria how to name it. And the main thing which I discovered that we are programmed to die not only on the cell level, but on the mind level. Because only being programmed to die on the mindset level can find some explanation why everyone is busy with everything, especially with earning money, than in the focusing on breaking death problem, with all powers people have. And they're focusing on everything besides breaking the aging problem, which probably will kill them one day. But sending spaceships into the moon, to the moon or to Mars, or building the tallest buildings will not help. So that maybe explains that there are less than maybe 10,000 professionals in longevity field across the globe today. And compare with the amount of lawyers, for example, right? So you understand that basically nobody cares about what we all do in this field, and this is devastating. Also, I learned that medical and scientific institutes are highly bureaucratical. They are building stupid barriers to share any data. That's why I believe the data should be shared freely without any barriers and bureaucratical laws. For that, for example, we have made an anonymous token for avoid these barriers. So all the medical profiles which any hospital wants to share with us, for example, we can share this anonymization token, and they can anonymize it with just few clicks and give us without any personal data related to that customer, I mean patient, and we can work with this data. I mean, all data scientists can work. And can you imagine how many data sets available in open sources out of which we can make disease prediction models? 3 million only out of 8 billion population, out of maybe 5 billion who died during last 50, 60 years. So there are only 3 million in open sources on which you can build disease prediction models, and we use them all. And we have built about 30 disease prediction models based on tabular data and images data. And that's ridiculously low. Combining with this argument that the closed source data is very bureaucratical, so we are in the dead end of that. So since my and this section is about big data, so we have like a great dead end in front of us to use big data from the tabular and images data to make some prediction disease models. Some of the speakers yesterday and today, they said that prevention medicine is very important and the using of AI and machine learning algorithms and so on. But how you can train data if you don't have data, right? So going back to the mindset, you can also see that we have 100 rooms, 100 members in this room, and we have like 50 seats empty. And we, with Ilya, messaged this message to some related to longevity and anti-aging movement professionals, and even they didn't join it. That means it shows even from longevity-focused people that maybe what we are doing is also not so much important for them. You can say that they're going to listen to the recording later, but still. So my point is that going to the content of this is that longevity has huge problems, and we believe that AI and machine learning methods, they can resolve these problems. Look, for example, for the business model in longevity today. You all know that tickets to summits, selling books, speeches, and only nutrition supplements are the only four business models in longevity, and nobody's selling anything besides that because there is no products for longevity, and that's why the investors are not coming into this field. Not coming, not like Bezos with 3 billion, which is very doubtable amount, and other significant investors, but I mean like institutional investors who are investing in edtech or fintech billions every month, which are not investing anything in every month to our industry. So why I'm starting all this? It brought me to conclusion that the only solution to live longer today is not to die, and not to die by curing the diseases and monitoring them. So it's meaning to avoid severe diseases, screening yourself on few hundred parameters as frequent as possible, and bringing AI, ML, and big data to focus. And I decided not to change mindset of people because otherwise I'll be dead already. I'm right now 46, and I don't have time like Steve Jobs, who was changing the mindset, and look where he is. He changed the mindset in 2007, and 2011 he was dead. Of course, you can say that it's irrelevant, he wasn't curing himself, but it shows no matter how rich you are, which access to technologies you have, and how much funds and doctors and so whatsoever, you're not guaranteed that you're gonna live longer. Look at the mother of Bill Gates, she died in 65, or Paul Allen, the partner of Bill Gates, he died in 64. So I founded in US company, Longevity in Time, which started the research and development in early stages diagnostics. I hired 70 people from 25 countries with zero burn rate. I mean, they're working literally for free. Well, of course, I give them equity of our company, but that's not the point. They believe that with the coding, they can't resist early death. And that's significant because I think with that business model, I mean, the model of people working with zero burn rate, we're one of the biggest biotech companies right now. Look at our closest competitor, iCarbonix. It was the biggest before Altus Apps. The founder of raised funds like the 1 billion from Tencent Corporation, which has the WeChat in China. They raised 1 billion in 2017. You know, where are they now? iCarbonix, Chinese company, which was led by Beijing CEO of Genetic Institute, Zhou Wang, is bankrupt because they were like paying a huge amount of salaries like Altus Labs does with his scientific board, but they haven't done anything. I mean, look at their website. They have like three people there, and the latest news is from 2019. So summarizing all this, we're making a digital biobank, which can, in a mobile app, collect data, because medical institutions are not sharing with us. The open source is covered completely by us. Then we decide to give value to these users who are going to share us with data, to give their personalized predictions and recommendations based on our proprietary method of calculating what's going to happen with them if they're going to share this data. I mean the historical data, and patented the method that anytime any part of the data changes, we recalculate all the risk predictions and recommendations to avoid these risks. So by this, we involve the machine learning. Of course, machine is programmed by humans, and the outcomes of the machine results should be monitored by humans as well. But we involve machines to avoid this huge amount of doctors' mistakes, which are counted in civilized countries and not counted in not civilized countries. And we attached this technology to the evidence-based sources, I mean like PubMed, and developed the method of structuring unstructured, we call it, well, big data of evidence-based articles. Like you as all scientists, you have your team, you have your employees who are researchers, right? For example, yesterday it was told that the Spark 7 like has about 1,000 evidence-based articles. I mean, who counted them and who read them all? I'm sure that there is a great flow of scientific articles coming on different issues, and I'm not sure that everybody present in the room read them all. You read the summary, you read the abstract, you read some key things, but you can miss some, you know, the devil in details. You can miss the details. So we attached this early disease prediction model to the method of structuring unstructured medical data by, well, we call it less primitive than Google search. So what we do, if you would ask any kind of specific question, we can give you the very detailed reply based on evidence-based articles. And we can give you a link supporting that. And and we believe this is the great combination of early stages disease diagnostics and evidence-based reports, which can lead you to second opinion, clinical decision supporting system, you name it, with the real value of what your recommendations are based on. Because anyway, no matter how Nobel Prizes in Autos labs or education of professionals, we're all humans, and we can be calculated by, I don't know, 10 fingers, right? How many could be in the board or in consilium, so on. But when you will ask the same question which you ask to the reputable doctor, to the big data of evidence-based articles, we can extract as many articles which relevant to your question as exist in the public medical databases. And this could be thousands, hundred thousands, maybe tens, maybe zero, but we're gonna get them all. And it would not be irrelevant to some, you know, noise when you make a Google search request and you get all the garbage which goes in the reply. It would be strictly stick to your question. And very important for parsing the same kind of evidence-based articles on different languages. So of course we understand that English is the main language, but how many Korean and Chinese and or Russians are making not interpreted scientific-based articles, and they are not translated in English by some reason? So we added to this method the translation of national languages of that evidence-based articles. So so this is basically it. And just a few words on the summary of what we do in our company regarding additional works on the longevity. We also believe, and I asked that question in the beginning of yesterday's session, the AI simulations. Like I said, correct me if I'm wrong, there are no clinical trials on humans being held, and there is a longevity paradox. How you can hold a longevity clinical trial without seeing this person lives or dies in 50, 60 years? You would say, okay, there are some kind of protocols by which you can predict the trajectory that he will not die because of that and this, but come on, who can give 100% guarantee that the new drug or intervention to fight the aging or the makes active longevity possible will not get the severe side effects in 50, 60 years. For example, resveratrol, like everybody's obsessed drinking it. Okay, I mean the vitamins, I mean, the tablet. But who made a trajectory that this resveratrol will not drive us to some critical stage of something in 10 years, say? Okay, so I believe AI simulations of clinical trials is the potential, maybe small, but still a key to that locked door. And this is the other thing what we do. So basically it's a collecting of a huge amount of data from users, and we plan to pay those users for giving them their data. And we ask them to play in our longevity game, because we realized during these 4 years of the research, like I said in the beginning, people don't care about what we do, guys and ladies, I'm sorry, but they care about money. So let's invite them on our field and play on their rules. Okay, so for that we developed like longevity coin cryptocurrency. Okay, maybe it's now worth of zero, like Bitcoin 2007, but at least we're the only application who are giving them something in exchange for their boring experience in any kind of health app. Of course, we try to make our app not that boring. And in that presentation, which Didier will share, you will have the simulation of our updated app with this coins and how you can link our application to your digital twin avatar in the game. And you're gonna see how this avatar lives or dies if you don't change anything with your health application data, which was downloaded into your health application. So in other words, we are trying to get some monetary part, the gaming part, into this boring process of anything related to health, which users think it is. You just check it out. We tested 2 years ago. We made an advertising campaign like in Japan and South Korea, in all other countries. Almost none of them subscribed. But huge amount, like 7,000 people subscribed in India, in Bangladesh, in Somali, in other third-rate countries. Well, I mean, India, of course, is a developed country, but I mean from the access to medical technologies, to medical labs, they are very, very far away. So out of the 7,000, we got 825 subscribed users. And you know how many of them were paying users? None. That means that people are not interested, even if the stake is their life. So during these 2 years, we made this research on the feedback of the users, and we made this new application. You will see that you see this. So this is the one. The second is structuring of unstructured medical data with evidence-based sources, clinical trials, simulation of clinical trials, and the anonymization of medical profiles to avoid the barriers, bureaucratic barriers. And the last statement, I contacted most of you in different groups and sent you some requests that, like, if you have access to medical profiles, please help us. If you have access to some outcomes of past clinical trials, so we can make simulation on the past clinical trials on which we can make then train the model and then make the simulation of the future clinical trials, which would be highly hard. Well, mostly none of you replied. I mean, even if we have warm leads with you. So my urge to the society, help the companies like ours. If you don't like our company, no problem, help others. Share the medical profile data, anonymization, anonymized way, and help the companies who are dealing with AI simulations with sharing with the clinical trials data on which they can be trained and made new models. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you, Oleg. I really appreciate your strident approach. I'm not seeing a lot of questions right off the bat here, but it strikes me that people are in denial about the forces that oppose longevity. You know, I'm retired. The government has to send me money every month. So me dying saves them money. And also there's a lot of people that, you know, are kind of, shall we say, racists or you know, population control fanatics. Not everybody agrees with us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what I can say about aging, anti-aging advocacy, we filed a petition in 55 countries on 28 national languages 1.5 years ago. You can check it. Longevity Dividend, Martin Odia was very helping us with the making the proper message. So the idea of this longevity petition is like stop spending on anything besides, well, not besides, of course, start spending at least 5% of your GDP on anti-aging fundamental research. And you know how many we have signed votes during 1.5 years? No. We are the biggest longevity petition in the world. And you can just guess, 4,000 votes only. If tomorrow, any one of you are gonna put a petition regarding a cat on a tree, in 1 hour, you'll get 100,000 in any location. Nobody cares about that. So we need to make a game changer. We need to invite on our field, on longevity field, anybody, but to play on their rules, because there's no time of changing their mindset. I'm already like 10% of my life in this. And you guys like maybe 20, maybe 30, somebody's 50% of their life. But you see that there's no dramatic change. Look at the topics on the conferences. Basically, they are more or less the same during the few years. I'm sorry that I'm saying all this. It's very closed audience right now. But I'm really don't want to die. The only reason I started this company is because I don't want to die. And I'm tired. I was tired going and begging to everyone, just give me this, give me that. And then I realized, okay, I'll spend the time on the product, making myself what I need. That's why I assembled, well, in the first year, we had only 20 people. Like right now we have 70, and we have like 100 in a row going to work with us, this IT developers, for free. Yeah. Because they don't want to die.
I think we all share your frustration in this matter where we just aren't getting things done. But look, there's a few questions here. We see Liz. Take it away, Liz.
I just want to say thank you, Oleg, for your initiatives. You probably did reach out to us. For us to handle the medical data from patients is a lot of red tape. So it's very difficult for us to begin with. And we cannot just hand it off to other organizations. Everyone in the organizations has to sign off on compliancy. So it may be more difficult for some companies to share data, especially if it's not their personal data, than you think. And I can also reflect that we need people to take a bigger interest in this area. We had the timekeeper kit, which we thought, you know, people would be very interested in. It was 9 different clocks and, you know, DNA methylation, epigenetic aging. It was the most advanced. And I think over a year, we had 350 customers. And that's not enough to keep anything in business. So I definitely share your frustration. I do think that it's a matter of education. And we've had a lot of blocking of that communication to the general public for unknown reasons, but hopefully we will have a better trajectory in the next year or two.
Well, education is a nice word for it. What's really needed is out and out propaganda campaign. There needs to be just the way, I mean, you know, for instance, the propaganda campaign to implement vaccinations. Imagine if we had a similar organized propaganda campaign to advance longevity science and so on. I mean, we would make huge gains. Why isn't that happening? You must ask yourself that. There's a reason why that's happening. It's not just ignorance, it's conscious.
This mindset of people, like I said, we're programmed on the mindset level.
Well, it's political too. It's very political. You think Nancy Pelosi doesn't know about this? You think, you know, Joe Biden doesn't know about this? Yeah, of course they do, but they're not doing anything. So,
well, trust me, they don't think about it.
Sorry. It goes back to Stefan's conversation of that we do need to share data, but we're still, you know, trying to find the devil and criminalizing certain mindsets of business in which, you know, actually translates medicine to people. So it's like we even internally have a lot of cognitive biases that we need to overcome in order to really get things moving. And I was not able to unmute before the break, but the truth is that healthcare should be free. This shouldn't be a profit center. Human enhancement is a great area for profit center. Unfortunately, the new medicine of extending healthy lifespan will blur the bounds of enhancement in preventative medicine, but that's a great problem to have. So, you know, I do picture in the future, as we open our borders and open our minds, certainly there will not be a profit center to health, because health indicatively is a profit center for the world. Mm. And we will be working on other problems in the entrepreneurship that are profitable. But right now, without generating profits and patents and things like that, you can't get investment in this space. So the data and the mindset and the profitability, and I think that you profit from a good drug. You profit from healthy longevity. You profit from your data sharing by getting that drug faster. And so, you know, again, cognitive biases seem to be hurting our area more than anything. And a lot of people come to me, interviewers, and they think that this is just a hedonistic area, because they have not been diagnosed yet. They do not know what it's like to have a disease. They do not know what it's like to be reached out by, you know, 10 people every month who are dying in the next few weeks of something, and you can't give them access to anything because it's not legal. You know, we have to almost live in the empathy of dying right now to solve this problem later. And so I think that we really have to amp up our communication and education to the world in urgency, the same urgency that was shifted towards a COVID vaccine, because people were dying and people felt empathetic about it. Aging is killing a lot more people this year than COVID will, you know, combined the last few years. So I think that we have to talk better on that.
So I should move on.
Can I just quickly? Yeah, Liz, please ask your lawyers, do these regulations apply to anonymized data? Because we don't need their SSN or mobile or anything. We just need 005 for John Smith. And you only know that John Smith is 005. And we have the 005 profile, and that's it. And it's absolutely anonymous. You don't need to ask the consent of that person, because you're not sharing anything linking to him.
Well, the problem is, like, for example, George Church and Harvard and the Human Genome Project pointed out that with enough data, you could actually correlate the information back to almost a specific person. And that, as we have massive amounts of data, will be more difficult to do, is what I'm telling you, than it is today. So that was their positioning, which made it a very global mindset that with a whole genome sequence and a couple other of things, especially like your environment where you live, because it is tied to how long you will live, the air you're breathing and the food that you eat, that was enough to correlate to a specific person. So, you know, again, we have to break down the mindset of transparency and what is transparent and what is opaque.
Okay, so I really need to cut you off here and let Didier get in. We're
just one sentence.
Okay.
One sentence. In our app, we collect historical data of users for like a few years, and then we plan to make prediction models precisely to this user, because right now we make prediction to precise user based on general open source data on which we trained models. So this is a key, including environment and behavioral and all that other parameters. But this is the key: to have 99.9% accuracy to you personally, we need to collect your own data. And it's possible only by such applications as this, because you don't collect historical data of any of your clients for 5 years with like 400 parameters, doing it like four times a year per year. Right. And this is the key to make a healthy longevity today. And we can make radical longevity up to 120. And we have this extra 40 years until fundamental science will develop something which like a pill. Well, you know, it's not what I believe in, but like a pill, like, right, you're going to develop it and maybe it will suit you in this 40 years extra time you won by the early stages diagnostic made by the historical data. That's why we say your data can cure you.
Okay. So that was all exciting. if only open borders were expanding instead of receding.